My name is Cindy, and I live in Ohio. In 1999, I took a friend camping for their first time ever for camping. I drove over 2 hours away from my town that sits around the middle of Ohio. This trip, I took my friend out to the other side of Zanesville, to a wooded area I had never been to. I drove down into the woods a little over 3 miles. There wasn't a road. I drove between the trees since they were far enough apart from my little Toyota. I found a small clearing and parked. I got out a tent and made a fire, then set up the tent, fixed some dinner, and then some coffee. I drank a lot of coffee at that point. My friend Shelley was not that comfortable with the idea of camping in the middle of nowhere, but it was a great end to the day. The sun was low in the sky, and it was cooling off a little. It was the end of June, so there was no wind. Just listening to the birds and the bugs, and unwinding after the drive. We talked and watched the fire till around 11 o'clock or so, when I heard a tree fall over. I really didn't think much on it. Trees fall, so no big deal. A few minutes later, I heard another tree fall. This went on for a while. At this point, I had my axe at my feet. I thought maybe it's a black bear or something. I built up the fire, and for a while I didn't hear any more trees fall, so I went to bed. My friend Shelley was already asleep. Then I heard another tree fall, but much closer, which freaked me out, so I got up with axe in hand. I couldn't see too much at first. The fire was near gone, so I threw some wood on the fire and started looking around, but not moving far from the fire. I was worried a bear was out there, since I had learned that black bears were back in Ohio, but thought they were far south from where we were. As my eyes got used to the low light, I strained to look between the trees. I could make out a shadow, tall and dark, staying back in the trees. At first, I thought I was not seeing anything, only maybe a shadow play or something. Then it moved. There was no way I could drive out of these woods in the dark, and staying, I wasn't good with that either. Shelley somehow was sleeping through it all. I didn't take my eyes off of where I saw this tall, dark, moving creature. It was, I would say, 8 feet tall from where its head was against the tree. But it's only a guess since it was 25 to 30 feet from where I was standing. But no more trees fell. It slowly moved away from where it had been standing after about 2 minutes. It seemed a lifetime passed in those 2 minutes. But no way was it a bear. I sat up until light, packed up, and we got out of there. We went to a campground at first light. That was my Bigfoot scary night in the woods. Nance, that was one crazy night. I've camped out since, but I don't go places that I've not been to before, and I take a gun now. Hi, Nance. I listen to you while I'm going to work and in between driving to patients' homes. I have had a sighting. It was September 1st, 2019, around 2 in the afternoon. My husband and a friend and I were scouting areas in North Georgia. My husband is fanatical about me getting out of his sight. But while going up a rather steep spot, they stopped to look at something. I went on to the top while I had the momentum. When I got to the top of the ridge, I could see where we had left our cars way down below. But in my mind, I was thinking they should be right below. Instead, they were off to the left. So I was looking down at the small roads below. My husband and friend were still down the ridge some, so not within eyesight. I heard something off to my right at about my 4 o'clock. I immediately looked straight to where I heard the noise. That's when I saw him. He was behind a tree. He was looking at me, and I was looking at him about 25 yards away. I saw him lean to the left of the tree, and in my mind what was registering was how wide his shoulders were, because when he leaned, his right shoulder was still on the other side of the tree. I was a cop for 20 years, so I know how to take in details and give descriptions. If I had called this out, I would have said he was approximately 6 feet tall. I called out for my husband. They were still down the ridge. When I saw him lean to the left, I called out again, this time with more urgency. They started coming up the ridge quickly. Then, just like a puff of smoke, it was gone. The hair on him was a reddish-brown color, and his face was a different color, kind of like a clay-gray color. They made it up the ridge, and I pointed the direction and said, "I just saw a Bigfoot." My friend ran to where I saw it, and I followed. I didn't know it till I got there, but where he had been standing was on a downward slope, so it had to be much taller than 6 foot. There were prints on the ground where something had dug in and took off in a hurry. Oh, and one more thing. There was very fresh scat. Huge scat. My husband is an avid hunter, and he could not say what it was from, but he could say what it was not from. Not a bear, hog, or any other wildlife in the area. I can't explain the feeling. I was shaking all over from the rush, but never ever at any time did I feel I was in danger. As a matter of fact, I still go out, and it's made me more calm. What I saw was not an animal. It looked more like a huge man wearing a fur coat. I think he meant for me to see him. Otherwise, I never would have specifically looked that way. Thanks for reading my story, Sheila. We live close to the Brush Creek Wilderness area, which I suspect is where the Bigfoot that we saw is probably living. The back of our house is just over 100 feet away from the tract of trees that leads into the Brush Creek Wilderness area. We have just under 4 acres, with much of it running along the road out front in some odd shapes. Between the trees out back and the road, we have a solid 2 acres clear cut, leaving some acreage on either side fully wooded. Our house sits further back in one particular area of the lot. This means the trees closest to the house are out back. Myself, my son, and my son-in-law had spent the day removing the old deck on the back of the house, and we were in the process of replacing it. It was September 2017. We had been at it most of the day and called it quits around 5. We grilled, ate our dinner, and then sat around a fire pit that we had out in the yard away from the house. We routinely threw brush and trimmings and other odds and ends of yard debris into that pit all the time, so there was usually something out there that needed to be burned anyway. We had gotten the fire going real good and were sitting and talking about what we were going to do the next day. That's when a large limb flies over our heads. It came from the direction of the trees. We all looked at each other like, "What the heck?" And then we were all looking toward the trees. We were actually talking about if it could be the wind or if someone was out there that shouldn't be, when another limb flew out and smacked my son-in-law right in the leg. So that was no accident. We decided we were going to go run off whoever it was when my son grabbed my arm and pointed as we were about halfway to the tree line. We all three stopped and looked. It wasn't dark yet, but it was right before it does really get dark. What I was able to see was a large, dark shape moving between the trees, only about 30 feet or so away from where we stood. As we were looking, there came another limb flying, and this one seemed to have more force to it. You could hear the whipping sound it made as it went through the air over our heads. It just went sailing right over us. My son yelled out that this was private property and that they had better leave. By that time, I had a suspicion of what was out there, but I know he didn't. Then it came out closer to the very edge of the trees, and now all three of us could see it much better. It was covered in fur. I don't know what color, but it didn't seem quite as dark as full black, but pretty close, I'd say. Its body was wide and muscular, and it had really long arms. I remember the arms, because as I was looking at it, it was winding up with another limb. It didn't pull back to throw like a human would, but it held it low down by its legs, and then it pulled it backwards in an underhand style, then whipped it up and let go of it. I remember thinking how awkward it looked, even while I was watching the creature do it. It was holding a few more limbs in its other hand. And also, the limbs weren't big around, maybe a man's thumb size around. By now, we were heading for the house. We were out there, we had no flashlights or guns. Once inside, I told the boys we weren't going back out, that I was pretty sure it was a Bigfoot, and we should just leave it be. I think if I had said that to them earlier in the day, they would have laughed at me. But they weren't laughing. They did believe me, and we did stay inside and leave it alone. The next day, I went out and we checked out the limbs that it had been throwing. It looked like all the shoot-off branches of the limb had been broken off, so while it wasn't quite a spear, it seemed to have something in mind when it was doing that. After that, I've tried to keep a lookout and listening for them, but nothing since. It's the strangest thing for it to show up, throw sticks, show itself, then go away and nothing else. And none of us recall any weird feelings before it all happened, and there were no sounds that any of us remember. Thanks a lot, Colin. This is my brother Ray's story. Before going into the specifics of his encounter, I want to say a little bit about my younger brother. Ray was a fireman for 20 years before he retired and became a state fire marshal. He is one of the toughest and most resilient people you will ever meet. Some of the tragic sights he saw as a firefighter would make some men weep, while my brother would just bear down all the harder. He is one of those guys who can get by on a cigarette instead of a meal or a drink or a night's sleep. He is scuba qualified, so he was on his department's recovery team and would bring in the bodies of drowning victims from many of the lakes in his little town. The pressures of being a fireman broke up his first marriage, and then he had an incredible good luck to meet and marry Joanne, a vivacious, curly-haired brunette. Her optimism and charm brought him back after a couple years of depression. Joanne is smart, funny, and cheerful, not in that ever ongoing annoying way, but genuine and sincere. She's cool and unflappable. Joanne grew up in Chicago, but her family loved to get out and camp here in the Midwest and out in the far West. Her love for camping fit right in with Ray, and she knew a million good ghost and campfire stories. These events took place in Michigan's Upper Peninsula, near Paradise and the Tacopnon River and State Park area. Ray and Joanne were camping with two other couples, Mike and Carol and Mark and Tina. Mark was also a fireman. The six of them were in two vehicles and had parked in a small forested lot and backpacked into the primitive camping area, which Ray thought was maybe an hour and a half or 2 hour hike. It was a beautiful area, and it was early June, so the growth was spectacular and fresh. My brother, like me, has always experienced an almost spiritual joy in the wilderness. They made camp, and there was a nice fire ring already in the place. Ray said the campsite was clean, that whoever had been there before them had not left any trash or litter like you sometimes find. He said it was a good campsite in a small clearing, and to the west was a creek and an overgrown trail picked up beyond that. That first night, they grilled burgers, roasted corn, and had their s'mores. Though they did tote in two lanterns, they made a huge bonfire. They talked and told stories. There was a lot of insect drone, no wind. Joanne was telling the midnight caller when Ray said he felt the forest grow unnaturally quiet. He could see eyeshine outside the circle of campfire light, but he couldn't see what it was. During a pause, everyone picked up on the silence, and some thought they could hear footfalls. No one saw anything, and eventually the forest noises returned. Later, when they crawled into their tent, Ray told Joanne about seeing the eyes shine, and she said she had seen it as well, but was mystified about what it might have been, because it was taller than you might expect for deer. Ray told her it was probably an owl, and she said it must have been a big one. They went to sleep. Now, my brother struggles to sleep on the ground when camping, so he lay there for a long time, the comforting sound of Joanne's breathing beside him. Ray noticed again a drop-off in the insect sounds. He listened and thought he could hear someone walking outside the tent. Now, that's not unusual, as you often get deer or raccoons approaching a campsite at night. But Ray thought the footfalls sounded more deliberate, and that whatever it was walking on 2 feet. He thought maybe someone else was having trouble getting to sleep and had maybe gone out to pee or just to watch the moon. Then he realized he hadn't heard the sound of any tent flaps being unzipped when he heard the distinct click, pause, clack of something disturbing the rocks around the now burned down fire. Deer don't do that. Then Ray told me he heard a long, though low, exhale, and that whatever outside made that noise sounded big. Bear? He wasn't sure. He was ready to unzip his own tent when he heard and felt the footsteps coming closer. They approached the tent, and Ray was on alert now. Then he said something touched the top of their tent, and this was alarming, because that tent was a large one with a ridgepole over 6 feet off the ground, and no normally sized person would be able to lean across the tent roof to do that. Some of his tension must have communicated itself to Joanne, because she woke up then saying, "What? What?" Ray held her arm and made a low shushing sound. Together they listened as their visitor slowly and deliberately walked away. Ray said he really didn't think it had been a bear. The next morning dawned clear and uneventful. Ray and Joanne didn't know whether to tell the others what had happened or not. No one else mentioned anything unusual, and they decided not to alarm anyone by describing the events. No injury or damage had been done, though Ray did closely inspect the fire pit and confirmed the rock circle had been disordered. In the early afternoon, Ray and Joanne, with Mark and Tina, hiked over to the creek, crossed the shallow water on rocks, and began hiking on the trail. Mike and Carol stayed with the campsite. Ray said they found a low area where there were hundreds, maybe thousands, of tiny peeper frog hatchlings, like the trail was a living carpet of these small amphibians. Further on the trail, it wound past an old and abandoned house. Ray examined it and noticed the nails were all the old square kind. Evidently, this had once been a farm and the trail a proper road, because past the house was another clearing with a big junk pile and a lot of old and beat-up appliances, ancient things that had been discarded here. Second-growth timber now overspread the trail, and it was obvious no one had dumped junk here for many years. Just past that area was when Ray said he got a clear feeling of foreboding, that they were being watched, spied on, by persons or animals unseen. He mentioned this to Joanne, and silently she nodded. She felt it as well. Ray was about to say something to Mark and Tina when the forest again grew quiet. No insect sounds, no bird calls, just a little low rustle of breeze in the treetops. And that's when they saw it. They were downwind of a slight embankment, and there was a small rill at the bottom, and on the far side of a fallen log, A large bear sat digging in the earth. Ray took Joanne's hand in his and was just about to say, "Hey, there's a bear," when the bear turned its head over its shoulder to look at them, and then it stood up. Only it wasn't a bear. Joanne quietly said, "Oh my God." Ray said it was a Bigfoot, obvious as the nose on your face, and this was no bear. The thing was standing on two huge legs, like tree trunks. It regarded them, and Ray said what he remembered most was its huge girth, that at the shoulders it was the width of two or three men. It was a dark reddish brown. Its face was bare and flat, with small eyes, a peaked head, and very small ears, and a large and flat nose. Ray said it wasn't human, but it had a human aspect about it. They all saw it now, and everyone stopped. The thing pivoted slowly, and looking directly at them, it sniffed the air slowly. Ray said that's when he got scared, really scared, because it was clear it had seen them, and it had a dispassionate yet clear intelligence. He and Mark turned the women around and said, "Let's go, let's get out of here." It took them maybe 40 minutes, double timing, to get back to their campsite, and Ray said he felt afraid but numb at the same time, like he was watching himself from outside his body, and he was wondering, how are we going to handle this? The six of them had a quick conference, and Ray and Joanne told the others about the preceding night's events, and it was decided to pack up and hike out of there. They had no firearms and no real weapons, just a couple of hatchets. Ray said it was tense to gather their gear and get everything packed without stopping every few minutes to reconnoitre the surrounding woods and get ready to travel, but that everyone managed themselves and they began their walk out. They had been hiking for a long while, mostly in silence, when Ray said they heard owl calls behind them and to their sides. But every one of them knew those weren't owl calls. Ray said he is pretty sure they were followed out of there by at least one or two of the creatures, though he didn't see them. And that was the toughest time because he knew they were getting close to the vehicles and so could leave. But was there one ahead waiting for them? But they got to the vehicles, loaded them quickly, and left. They stayed the next two nights in motels, and what hiking they did was on large, well-established and busy trails. And that is the end of their story. If you ask my brother if he believes in Bigfoot, he will just grin. He will put his arm around his beautiful wife, kiss the top of her head, and he will just grin at you. Minnesota is called the land of a thousand lakes, and there's a cabin on every one of those lakes, I think. In September 2017, my wife and I needed a bit of a break, so I rented one of those cabins for us for the week. The cabin was very nice. Truthfully, I couldn't have afforded to rent this particular cabin if it wasn't off-season and we were getting a great discount. Truthfully, it was more of a small house than some rustic cabin. It had air conditioning, internet, and satellite television. It was pretty upscale for a cabin, but again, it was off-season, so we got it cheap, and besides, we weren't going up there to watch television or surf the internet. The first night there, nothing happened. On the second night, there was lots of banging noises coming from the other side of the lake. Now, I did think that was kind of odd because there were two larger chalet-like cabins that we could see on the other side of the lake, but there hadn't been any lights in either of them and no activity during the day, and there weren't any lights in them at that time that I heard the banging. As far as I had gathered from the caretaker when we checked in, there were only two cabins rented out that week in that group, ours and another couple a few cabins away from us. I went out and stood on the porch deck that looked out over the lake. I looked to my right when I saw another light come on, and a few cabins down, I saw the other couple also coming out on their porch deck. We could clearly see each other. We sort of nodded to each other and shrugged after a while before we each went back into our cabins. The next day, we managed to meet up with that couple from the other cabin and struck up a conversation. They had been there for a few days longer than we had, and they said the banging wasn't the only odd thing that had been happening. He said that the night before we arrived, they were sitting out on their deck enjoying the night sky when something started making an awful screaming noise. Not across the lake where the banging was coming from, but behind the cabins in the woods across from the loop road. It hadn't happened since, though, he said. Now, I didn't know quite what to think, but there was that banging going on, so I thought anything was possible, and if he said he heard a scream, he heard a scream. I'm not a hunter, so I don't know all the sounds wild animals make. The lake area had small boats that you could paddle out onto the lake with. So one afternoon, my wife and I paddled out and around the lake just to see what we could see. It was an overcast day, but visibility was good otherwise. There really wasn't a lot to see, just more trees and a few other cabins that I don't think belonged to the same group as ours, but they were down on the other end of the lake. Overall, it was just serene and quiet. I was getting pretty tired, so I paddled closer to the shore and followed it back and decided to head to our neck of the lake. That's when my wife saw the Bigfoot. She saw it first, then grabbed me, then I saw it. It wasn't moving. In fact, I almost missed what my wife was trying to point out to me as we slid by on the lake. It was a solid color, dark brown as far as I could tell. I'd say we were around 50 feet from it. We weren't far from the bank, and the trees came down low to the bank in that area. I could not see its eyes, but you know when you are looking at something and it's looking right back at you, even if you can't see its eyes. That was what happened right then. It was a few seconds as we slid by on the lake. I remember turning on the crossbench in the boat, looking at it as long as I could as we passed beyond it. And I saw that its shoulders had also turned and watched us retreating on the lake as we went by. I can't really judge the height. I don't know what the ground was like in that area, if it was standing on a depression in the ground or if the ground was level. I was also looking up at it at a slight angle since the bank rolled upwards. I will say its overall appearance to my eyes was much larger and taller than any human. That's as far as I can go. At that distance, I can't say much more for certain. Once I got over my initial shock, I began paddling like crazy to get back to the cabin. I suddenly wasn't tired anymore. I don't think fear or being afraid are the right words to use here. Intrusion is the word I want to use. I felt like we had somehow intruded, as weird as that might sound. We got back to the cabin, and my wife and I agreed on all the points about what we had just seen. Then things began to make sense. We debated on whether or not to tell the other couple down the way what we had seen, but we decided to tell them because it's not like we'd ever see them again, so if they thought we were crazy, well, no big loss. And yeah, they were a bit cool when we told them what we had seen. They quickly closed the conversation, and we noticed the private looks they were giving each other as we turned to leave. You know the kind. The ones that you have with just your eyes, and it's a whole conversation with your significant other saying, "These people are nuts." Snicker, snicker. But here's the interesting thing. They came back down just a couple hours later and suddenly wanted to talk to us more about what we had seen. Turns out they had looked up the Bigfoot stuff on the internet after we left their cabin. That's when they ran into some supposed Bigfoot howls and screams. They listened to them, and they were certain that it was just what they had heard previously. Then they read about wood knocks, and that's when they decided they needed to come back down and talk to us. We didn't have much more to tell them. We couldn't tell them anything more. The other man wanted to go out on his own Finding Bigfoot expedition. I told him, "You go right on ahead," but I wasn't going out there with him. So that's it, Nance. We heard the wood knocks, but we never heard the screams that the other couple heard. We did float by and we did get to see it, but they never did. I want to say I'm sorry it wasn't an up-close kind of encounter with more detail and interaction, but that would be a lie, because I'm not sorry that it wasn't that way. The way it happened, with a good bit of distance between us, was just right for me. Thanks for letting me tell this, Bobby and Irene. Hi, Nance. Glad to finally get the chance to email you this encounter. Well, it was around 2017 when this happened. Me and my cousin were about 15 at the time. It was around the 3 days before the 4th of July. We had gone up to Komodo, New Mexico to visit my grandparents. We had always loved going there. It was so small and peaceful. We had built these forts probably 500 yards from the cabin, and all of us would head out there and mess around. Well, anyway, my cousins and I headed out to the forts to look around, as we hadn't been there for a few years. But to our surprise, the forts had been beaten and the wood used for them was spread all around. We had no idea what had happened, and so we blamed it on our grandfather, who always had the urge to prank us. Dinner wasn't quite ready yet, so my cousin and I decided that we would head out and explore for an hour or so. Now, mind you, this was a very particularly wooded area, away from anywhere, with lots of people. So we figured we could catch up on a few things and just hang out. Though as we were walking through a heavier wooded part of the forest, I had the sudden urge to get out of there. I didn't know why, though, so I didn't mention anything and just passed it off as my imagination. We continued walking when I caught a glimpse of something moving directly parallel to my cousin and I. I mentioned it to her and said, "Maybe we should turn back." She then said that she had felt something was wrong and agreed that we should turn back. When we began to walk back, my heart dropped to the pit of my stomach, and I almost booked it deeper into the forest. About 50 yards in front of us was what I knew was a Bigfoot. It was clearer than day that that thing wasn't a bear or any other big game animal. My cousin and I stood there in complete and utter fear. We were well around 2 miles away from the house and knew that none of our family would hear us if we screamed. That thing creeped toward us in the slightest of movements. But to our surprise, it turned and slowly walked out of view. In total panic, my cousin and I ran faster than I had ever ran in my life. When we got back, we told my father. Later that night, my father, my grandfather, my cousins, and I went out to hunt for that thing. As it began getting darker, we heard whoops and howls echoing around us. I was so tired, and every step was agony. But I was soon awake when I heard a branch break behind us. My father had heard it too. We turned around and saw that that thing was on the sideline of the path we were on. It was there. My father screamed for my grandfather and uncle to turn around, and when they did, the beast reached out its hand and slowly walked toward us, as you would to a horse. We all backed up in sync. It looked as if it wanted our trust or affection. I trusted it, though my father grabbed my cousin and I and started firing off shots. I was kicking and screaming, trying to stop him. There was something trusting about this animal, and I trusted it. So did my cousin, as I would learn later that night. My father and grandfather pushed us all home, and we all made it back to the house. I love my father, but I have never forgiven him for trying to kill it. It was so innocent, and I will add that it wasn't as big as I hear it must have been a young one, because it only seemed about 6 feet tall, maybe 6 feet and a half. But I only wish we had given it the chance to approach us. We haven't been back to that house since, because to our dismay, my grandparents sold the cabin. It had so many memories, but I'm glad I was able to share this with you. Sincerely, Bigfoot Lover. Just use that instead of my name. Thank you. Dear Nance, I too must remain anonymous to share this story, as around me in Western North Carolina, New Crusoe, North Carolina, many still are skeptical about Bigfoot's existence. Here goes my story. For several days in the spring of 1973, it had drizzled rain off and on, and at times it was windy with downpours. The river that runs through Crusoe spanned about 12 to 15 feet wide and was delightfully deep enough for all of us kids to water tube all the way to Canton. The river, mysteriously, had not rose very high with all this rain. Earlier in the day, the First Baptist Church had a picnic at Camp Hope, which is up Highway 276. I attended with my aunt, who was a member. The river runs alongside the highway for many miles. All of us kids had played in the river up until time to leave. Just below Camp Hope was a campground that many of us had spent many summers at. The owners were friends of my aunt, so we stopped to visit. I immediately went down to the river, to my favorite spot. The sun was going down, and the rain was still a drizzle. It was rather dark in the woods leading to my favorite spot down by the river. I had no fear at this point, but that quickly changed. I smelled a horrible smell and felt I was being watched. Something came up so fast behind me and literally stopped so abruptly that it threw dirt all over me. I turned to see a massive hairy creature towering over me, and I was 5'4". It had to be at least 8 feet tall. I froze, and in the deepest guttural voice it said to me, "Leave." I took off running for my life, hysterically crying my eyes out and screaming. I didn't tell what had happened to my aunt, but I said we needed to go now. She'd never seen me like this before, ever. So we said our goodbyes and left immediately. I got home, and my aunt told my mom what had happened with me. Just as she was telling my hysterical situation, my dad's CB ham radio announced a 1033, which stands for emergency over the air. It was calling for River Watch to meet at a nearby fire station. Apparently, earlier in the week, a tornado had dropped trees at the top of the mountain, and they formed a dam on the river that wasn't accessible or could be viewed from the highway in the higher elevations. A cloudburst occurred that afternoon, and the dam broke, sending a 30-foot-plus wall of water down the mountain. The campground, where I had been, was almost completely washed away, killing a 9-year-old little girl. During those days, we never spoke of Bigfoot, and for many years, I was puzzled about what had saved my life that day. Then one day, I watched a video of where a man had developed a verbal exchange with Bigfoot. It was an actual recording. I instantly got the confirmation to my suspicions. It was the same guttural voice that I had heard. I'm a wild animal rescuer, and I have had amazing success with wild animals, as they know I'm going to help them. I once had to bury a baby raccoon that I had fallen in love with. I was deep in the woods burying him and crying almost like a whale. Rocks kept being thrown from deep in the woods. I spoke to it, and again, I had another experience hearing it walking through the woods. It just knew I was okay and one of the good humans. It's not far from where I live now, and I know it watches me from time to time. But I'm not afraid now. Thank you, Nance, for letting me share my story. Squatch on. Nance, I wanted to tell you and your listeners my story. It's pretty simple. It was 2015, me and my brother were hiking in the Bitterroots in Montana. At the time we ran into a Sasquatch, we were on the Tin Cup Creek Trail. It's a pretty easy trail most of the way. The trail also runs mostly parallel to Tin Cup Creek, which we could see at times through the timber on the trail. There is also a great amount of rock in that area. I believe it to be shale, but I'm not a geologist. We were coming through a stretch of dense timber when we could hear the sound of rocks sliding and tumbling, as if something was dislodging rocks while it climbed upward. We stopped and looked to our left where the timber opened out to a large, steep area covered in loose rock. We expected to see some type of large game, maybe even a mountain lion that we had perhaps startled. But to our shock, what we saw was a large biped covered in dark fur going up through the rocky area to the left of the trail. We only had perhaps a 2-second view of it before it disappeared again into more timber. We could hear it for several more seconds, but we could not see it. My brother and I looked at each other in amazement. He said, "That was a Sasquatch." And I said, "I know." Now that sounds funny, but that's all I could manage to say. We were uncertain what we should do, so we stayed at the edge of the timber opening for a few minutes, and we discussed whether we should go forward or turn back. We figured we were roughly about 8 miles into the trail, but as we were only lightly armed, we decided to turn back. We were armed to protect ourselves against, possibly, other humans, or to scare off something such as a mountain lion. We did not have firepower to take on what we saw climbing up those rocks. We were raised to follow our gut feelings about things, so that's what we did, and we decided to go ahead and turn back. For the first mile or so, going back out of that area, we felt as if we were being watched or followed, though that may have just been our collective paranoia. What we saw couldn't have possibly been a bear, a lion, or anything else. The legs and buttocks were mostly what I could see of the thing as it leaned forward slightly and away from us while it scrambled through the loose rock up and into the timber. That thing moved through the rocky area with no difficulty. I knew of no animal that could go through rock uphill on only 2 legs, except maybe a Sasquatch. Please keep my name out of it, or you can call me something like Billy. Thanks a lot. I'll build you up to where and why. My friend and I have hunted 3 years along the Sugar Creek River until the owner sold it, so we tried to find a new place. We lucked out. A fellow we worked with purchased a nice bit of land on the outskirts of Tangier, Indiana. His property ran very near to Turkey Run State Park. That day we started off. I went one way, he the other. I was 30 minutes in easily. I found a nice high ridgeline overlooking at least 3 gullies that opened up right to me. I'll tell you, I wash my gear in non-phosphorus soap, and I store my clothing in a bag with leaves and a few shovels of dirt. It's a perfect scent cover. I went up to a nice tree, a beautiful blind to get the best shot. I got out my binoculars and just sat very still. I heard some odd sounds, so I looked and was almost in shock at what I saw. I said to myself, "No, can't be." But there in clear sight, 25 yards or so, this 8 to 9 feet tall creature with reddish-brown long hair. The teeth were smooth, but the canines were pointed. Its face and hands were a brownish-gray color. It was every bit of 5 feet wide. I was in awe. It was a Bigfoot, making, I assumed, a resting place in the pine trees. It reached up 15 feet at least, and snapped branches, and I mean 3 to 4 inches around. Just snap, clean break. Not split or splintered, but clean. The breeze was from the side, not towards it or me. I sat there in a dazed state 10 to 15 minutes. After sitting a spell, I got this overwhelming feeling that if it wanted to harm me, I couldn't stop it. So I eased down the ridge as fast as I could without making noise, and luckily everything was kind of damp. About 10 minutes later, I found a fence line and proceeded to follow it. I heard a few rustling sounds, and I knew it was on the move. I came across this old Coca-Cola truck, like 40s or early 50s. It was sunk up to the seat springs, and the box was the same. I'm 6'4", and I could see in it, and I couldn't believe it, but standing in it were 2 deer. They were hunkered down. I could have reached out and touched them. They never moved. They were staring where I had come from and paid no attention to me. I got really freaked out. I heard more loud noises coming toward my direction. I ran till I came to an opening in the fence that opened out to a field where my truck was parked on the other ridge. I crossed that field like an Olympic runner. I got to my truck and heard a god-awful kind of grunt screaming sound. I turned, and it was standing in the opening across that field. My hair was on end. I have never mistreated my shotgun, but I threw it in the bed and fired up my old Dodge and never even warmed it up. My foot was shaking so bad, I couldn't hold the pedal to the floor. I've only told a few people over the years. My brother believes me, but he said, "I would have shot it. Why didn't you?" And in an instant I told him. I knew it wouldn't do anything but piss it off. When I reached the friend's house, my buddy was there waiting. He had smelled a horrible smell and felt watched, so he walked back. I never told him what I saw, but I asked the fellow whose land I was hunting on if he had had any weird happenings. He said yes. Noises and things disappearing, but paid no attention to them. "Why?" he asked. "Never mind," I said. That day was my last day of hunting. I sold my 12-gauge and gear cheap. The few people I have told believe me. My eyes watered and my hair stood on end, and they knew I was telling them the truth. I got physically shaken the few times I talked about it. I've researched it and found there have been reports in that area. So there you have it. That is my monster in Indiana story. If you want, you can use the first letter in my name, J. Looking forward to hearing how you tell it. Thanks, Nance. Back in 2012, I was kayak fishing on the Uhari River in North Carolina. I was fishing a brush pile I had found. A nice older lady pulled up beside my kayak in an aluminum John boat and asked if she could fish with me because she had noticed that I was having great luck as I had caught a nice bass as she was approaching my kayak. If she told me her name, I can't recall. As I said, this was back in 2012. She had the biggest dog that I had ever seen in the boat with her. I do remember his name, Thor, as he was a monster of a canine. He must have weighed close to 150 pounds. I can't remember what breed he was, but he was a hoss of a dog. I was glad to have someone to talk to, and we conversed as we fished. She told me that she lived on the river, just her and Thor, and had done so for almost 10 years. She struck me as a very self-reliant lady, and as a country boy myself, I admired her for that. So we talked and fished for the better part of an hour, both of us having much success in filling our stringers. I mentioned that the deer herds were really expanding in North Carolina, and with them were packs of coyotes. I asked her if she had heard or seen any coyotes along the river. Suddenly, her face grew dark, and she spoke in a hushed tone. "No, but I'll tell you what I did see," she confided. "Do you know where this creek to our left thins out into a stream from the woods?" she asked in a hushed tone. I replied that I did, as I had paddled up there before. "Well," she said, "I used to beach my boat there, where the creek comes out of the woods, but not anymore." I listened intently as she told me the story of her encounter with something that she could not comprehend. She had beached her boat, as she often did, to let Thor disembark to relieve himself. Again, Thor is a huge dog and, as she confided, has never been afraid of anyone or anything, that is, until that day. He had been whining and complaining that he needed to pee, so she paused her fishing and headed up the creek to let him off the boat. When she arrived at the head of the creek, Thor would not jump off of the boat as he usually did. He stepped on the bow of the boat and sniffed the air. His hackles rose on his back, and he just stood there, frozen. He never barked or even growled. He just stared into the woods, sniffing whatever it was that he was smelling. The lady said that she followed his gaze, and what she saw standing in the woods was either an ape or a very large person in an ape suit. As she stared at this ape-like figure, it crouched down behind a fallen tree trunk. Then it peered out at them from behind its cover. Thor went to the back of the boat and hid. So there were two things that she witnessed that day that she had never seen before: an ape in the Uhari forest, and her fearless dog tucking his tail in fear. Hi, Nance. This story takes place in southern Wayne County, Indiana. My son and I were out on a hot August night 5 years ago doing some research, as we run a small group of about 5 people. On this night, we were en route to a site when out of a ditch climbs what we think is a collie dog. But to our shock, it stands up in front of my car and we hit it, fully run it over. We get out with only clubs for defense and cameras as well, but to our surprise, no Bigfoot behind the car. But we seen a blood trail leading into these woods adjacent to the car, so we followed it in. After about 10 or 15 minutes, we lose the trail, and we stop and I say, "Son, look, it's an injured wild animal and it's scared. If it's nearby, it could attack. We have clubs." Seeing it was 6.5 to 7 feet tall and about 350 pounds, and we're 6 feet tall, and I'm 225 and my son is 150 pounds, we were no match for it. So we backed out and returned in the morning, but we never found it. Well, 5 years go by, and last spring, I saw a 7-foot blonde Bigfoot near where the encounter happened. I pray that was him all healed and well. I call him the blonde one. We never filed a report because who would have believed us? But it did happen, and I have pics of the car damage. But I don't have that car any longer. I still have nightmares about it. Well, that's only one encounter. We have many. Thanks for the opportunity to tell my encounter, Dave. In August 2010, I owned a nice piece of land in Lawrence County, Ohio. Part of my property went up and over a ridgeline. Halfway down that ridgeline was an area that I had been told the previous owner had planned to build a house, but never did. This was a nice wide open view of the night sky from there. And this is where I took a lady friend of mine out to watch a Perseid meteor shower. I had the idea that this would be a romantic evening, but it turned out to be very unromantic. We had hiked up there around 10 p.m. The meteor showers could supposedly be seen anywhere between midnight and dawn, as I recall. I really wasn't into night sky watching, so I don't know much about it. But somewhere along the way, as I had been talking to her for a few weeks, she mentioned that she loved to watch the night sky. And when I heard about the meteor showers, well, this is how it got planned. It wasn't a tough hike from my house, so that's what we did. The plan was to lay out on a blanket, watch the meteor showers with a lot of talking to get to know each other even better in between the meteor bursts. It was very warm and humid, even at night. We had been sitting there for a couple of hours when we began to hear a strange noise coming from further up on the ridge over behind us. It was a sound unlike anything I'd ever heard up there. I can't say it was a whooping noise, and it wasn't a howl or a scream. I have no way to describe the sound to you other than it was loud, and it echoed and sounded unnatural to my ears. That's the best I can describe it. Now, I didn't want to let her know that I was feeling a bit weirded out in what was essentially my own backyard, so I didn't say anything. The sound stopped for a while and then started a few minutes later, but this time they sounded much closer, down on the ridge somewhere to the left of where we were. That startled me. That was a lot of distance to cover from sound to sound. She was busy watching the sky and the meteors that would go by. Of course, by that time there were quite a few. But I wasn't looking. My attention was now focused on those sounds. Now I was hearing wood snapping and movement from time to time. I had a good flashlight with me, which we had used to follow the trail up to the clearing. She was chattering away, and I asked her to be quiet. I flicked on the flashlight and scanned the trees over in that area several times. As soon as I turned on that flashlight, everything stopped and went silent. No more sounds of snaps or anything moving out there. After a minute or so, I turned the light off and told her to stay quiet. I wanted to listen. But as I listened, I heard nothing but the sound of night in the trees out there, which, on a calm night like that, was silence. After a few minutes, we went back to watching the meteors. But I couldn't relax. I was distracted now. I couldn't stop the feeling that we were being watched. It was now close to 2:30 in the morning. I had seen enough of the meteors and was thinking it was time to call it quits, but hadn't told her yet. It seemed the later we stayed, the heavier the meteor showers were, and she was very into watching them. But I was trying to think of a smooth way to call this night to a close, and that's when I began to get the scent of urine. Not like a human's urine, but more like an old, damp, urine-soaked mattress that had been left sitting in a damp, moldy, closed-up house for a long while. And yes, I'm sorry to say, I do know what that smells like. I once worked for 1-800-GOT-JUNK and had to clean out my share of evicted and foreclosed homes, so I do know a lot about disgusting smells. And this was off the charts. The smell was something more than anything I'd really encountered before, to be honest. It had an extra musky layer that I don't think I've ever encountered. Now my hackles were up. There was something about that scent that put me on alarm, and I did not like beyond just that it was a nasty smell. I got up suddenly, and she was surprised. I abruptly told her it was time to go. I know I was rude and abrupt, but I knew we needed to get down off that ridge now. She was taking her time trying to fold up the blanket, and I was scanning the trees along the area that I had last heard the noises with the flashlight. I thought I saw some eyeshine as I was scanning back and forth, so I scanned back, but now there was nothing there. I hurried her, and we started down the cleared area toward the path that went down to where my house banked up to the rise of the ridge. I realized then we would be walking through heavy trees and darkness for a while, and I didn't like that idea, but I liked the idea of sitting out in the open as a target even less. By now, she had noticed the scent too, and was asking me what it was. I told her I didn't know. She then asked, "Well, is it a bear?" I said, "No, I don't think so." And then she kept asking me the same question over and over. "What is it? What is that smell?" And I kept telling her I didn't know what it was. I was now getting irritated, and before we got to the tree-lined path, I leveled with her, and I told her that something wasn't right about all of this, and I needed her to be quiet so I could listen. She thought I was kidding, or just trying to scare her. Then I got really rude with her. I didn't want to, but I didn't have a choice. I told her she needs to shut her mouth while we're walking through these trees. Now that made her all sulky and she pouted, but I didn't care. I needed to get us down off that ridge and I needed to hear what was going on around us. We started along the path and hadn't gone maybe 20 or 30 feet in when I heard very fast crashing and tree limbs breaking and snapping. It sounded like something was coming toward us very quickly. I stopped and swung the flashlight over in that direction. Suddenly, the snapping noises stopped. After a moment, I kept us moving again. And then a few seconds later, the noises started right back again. But this time, I waited a second or two longer after we stopped before I flipped on the light. I wanted to give whatever it was a chance to get close enough so I could see maybe what it was. And I did. The first thing I saw was the eye shine again. I saw it blink and then turn away, but it was enough that I could train my flashlight right there. It was about 50 to 60 feet or so away. Now, my flashlight was around 500 lumens with a really good throw, so I could see it very clearly at that distance before it turned away. My guess is it was around 7 feet tall. The fur seemed very red in my flashlight, but that might have just been the light washing it out. The fur didn't seem long, or I should say, it didn't seem to have a shaggy appearance. It was muscular and very broad across the chest, but I could only mostly see the upper portion of this creature, as the foliage and undergrowth through there was pretty thick as it was summer. And I only caught a glimpse of the face, a fraction of a second maybe, before it turned away from the light when I flipped it on. And I don't think the face was all furry. It didn't reflect the same red as the body did, but I had only a moment's glance, so I'm not 100% certain. But in that fraction of a second, I knew what it was out there. And in that fraction of a second, she saw it too, and she started screaming, and then she began to run blindly past me down the path toward the house, leaving me standing there. I glanced back to see the Bigfoot was now retreating. I don't know if it was the light or her screaming that made it retreat, or maybe both. I was startled and scared, and I stood there for maybe a second and a half longer, watching its back retreat through the trees until it was out of sight. Then I began backing down the path, and I was swinging my flashlight all around and checking behind me every few steps. About 200 feet or so down the path, I suddenly heard something running toward me at a fast clip, but this time it was coming from the right side of the path. I swung the flashlight over, and I saw that it was the girl that I had taken up there. She was frantic, and she had gotten lost running in the dark. She saw the flashlight coming down the path and came running blindly for me. I will tell you truthfully, Nance, I was very scared. My legs were rubber, and I don't know how we made it back to the house, but we did. She kept asking me the whole way what it was, and I told her, truthfully, that I thought it was a Bigfoot, a Sasquatch. She didn't believe me and kept asking me, no, really, what was that out there? And she later accused me of pranking her and setting it all up somehow. I can't even imagine why she would think a guy would do that to her. I had made no moves on her or anything like that. She had also somehow neglected to notice that I was scared shitless as much as she was. So here's my thoughts on this. I think it was just a curious Bigfoot. I think if it had meant to harm us, I don't believe that my little flashlight in its eyes or her screaming would scare something that size off. I did hear odd things for the rest of that summer and into the autumn up there on the trees that went up to the ridge. But I didn't hear anything after that, nothing by the winter. I sold the land a few years ago only because I needed to move closer to help my aging parents in Pennsylvania. Otherwise, that piece of land, it was really heavenly. In hindsight, I wish I had done things differently that night. I wish I had waited to see what it would do. But Monday morning quarterbacking doesn't change anything, does it? I can't help what my response was. Thanks for telling my story, Nathan. Hello, Nance. My name is Nathaniel. I live in Florida, and I'm not sure if what happened to me will interest you or not, but I feel I need to share it. So let me start this off by saying that I am sorry for the length of this email, and it's fine if you don't believe me. It is hard to explain what happened in these woods, and honestly, I truly don't understand it. I've been having a hard time dealing with these occurrences, and it has put an intense fear in me that was not there before. I'm calling them occurrences because I did not physically see the source of them. Now, I've been an avid outdoorsman all my life. I love hiking, hunting, and fishing. I love nature and spotting wildlife and even listening to the sounds they make either while hunting, fishing, or just hiking. It's always brought me peace, and I've always felt extremely comfortable in the woods. I've lived in Florida for around 20 years, but I actually grew up in Springfield, Ohio, and hiked a lot around the C.J. Brown Reservoir and Buck Creek State Park there, as well as John Bryan State Park and Glen Helen and Yellow Springs when I was growing up. Honestly, I remember those areas fondly and never felt afraid or even remotely uncomfortable. Honestly, I feel uncomfortable in cities. I've traveled all over the East Coast for my previous job and always loved being in the middle of nowhere, just the site I was working at and the two other guys on the crew I worked with. But after these few occurrences, well, I can't shake them. I can't explain them away, and they are not anything I've ever dealt with before. And none of my friends or family who I've told can explain it away. After the last one, I'm hesitant. Well, if I'm being honest, I'm downright scared to go back into the woods to hunt or fish. All of these have happened in the Green Swamp Wildlife Management Area, and all were during the spring turkey season over the course of a few years. The first occurrences happened mid-April 2016. I had been running a little late that morning, and I picked out a spot that I had not scouted off of Grade Road. I grabbed my shotgun out of the back seat and put my 9mm in my leg holster. I carried a 9mm because of the hogs and snakes. I started walking in on one of the many fire roads. It was cold that morning. I could see my breath in my headlamp beam as I walked. About a quarter to half a mile down this fire path, both sides were thick with trees. To my left, they were just a few yards away. To the right, they were around 20 yards or so. I found a place that seemed perfect. Straight ahead is a decent field without a ton of palmettos. To the left, a dense stand of pine trees, and to my right, all the way down this little field, were cypress trees. I was excited about this spot, hoping I'd finally bag a turkey. As the sun started creeping up, I noticed a familiar and very unwanted sound coming from my right. It was a wild hog. I unholstered my pistol and listened as it came closer. By the time it was in view, the sun was up enough for me to see that I was dealing with a large black boar. It was only about 30 yards away, and I had nowhere to run. I was silently cursing myself out, and that's when I realized something else had the boar's attention. It was staring directly into the field, not moving. I'd never seen anything like it. It was frozen. It didn't even notice that I had raised my gun and I was aiming for it. Then the boar started cracking its jaws together fast and hard and scraping the ground with its feet. I was sitting with my back against an oak tree and my pistol aimed at this hog's head. and then this hog did what I've never seen before or since. It started backing up. It never took its eyes off the field, but backed up about 20 or so feet, and in an instant, that hog, who was easily one of the biggest I've ever seen, turned and bolted. I was stunned. I'd been treed a few times in the past, and I know that if you're that close, they don't run away, they will charge, and they can and they will kill you. But I don't think it even knew I was there. Then I realized the woods were silent, no birds, no insects, just the wind, which was weird. Then a whistling started. It startled me so bad, I almost pulled the trigger on my handgun. But I collected myself, and I stood up thinking it was maybe another hunter. So I whistled back just to let whoever it was know that I was there. That was a big mistake. The whistle changed into a steady, constant string of notes like nothing I'd ever heard before. It was eerie, and I could not spot the source. There was no other hunter out there that I could see. Then, more whistling off to my right in the cypress trees, and it was that same eerie tune, and it was coming closer. I decided I'd had enough of that spot and immediately wanted to get to the car. I had never felt like that before. As I made my way back towards the trail, I was trying to convince myself it was just a mockingbird or a hunter screwing with me. As I stepped out onto the fire trail, I instantly felt exposed and uneasy, like I was being watched. So I started moving quickly back to the road. The whistling noises had stopped now, but I was very aware of something following me in the thick brush of the pine trees. I couldn't see it, but knew from the sounds of the steps that it was large, as twigs don't crack that loud on pine straw unless you get some weight. I wondered if this was the same feeling an animal feels when it's in a hunter's sights. Finally, after an eternity of walking on legs that wanted to run, about 30 yards ahead, I saw the mouth to the trail, and I knew better, but I couldn't help myself, and I sprinted full speed towards the area that I had parked. And my heart sank when I realized whatever was in the woods was running with me. Its footsteps made heavy, flat thuds as it moved twigs and brush snapped, and all I could think was, it's going to get me. Whatever this is going to get me. Finally, the fire trail opened wide to the road, and I made it to the driver's side of my car. And I stopped. I wanted to see what was chasing me. I had a car between me and it, and my pistol was aimed at the woods, but nothing came out. Instead, from the edge of the pines, the whistling started again. Then it was joined on the other side of the trail by more whistling. I hadn't heard or seen anything in the cypress stand, which was only a few yards away from the trail the whole time. I fumbled for the keys, jumped in the car, and tore out of there as fast as I could. I didn't go back that year. In 2017, I only got a few days off in a row towards the end of turkey season, so I went back to Green Swamp, as it's close and open all week. I decided to hunt the side closer to the 471 gate on a road called Levee Grade. I had been talking to the guy at the gate, and he told me that he had seen two birds roost there the night before. Since he was stuck manning the gate, he gave me the location on the condition that if I found them, I'd take the smaller one. I agreed and went on to the spot on the GPS he marked. As the sun started creeping up, I could see the faint outline of two turkeys roosted in a big pine on the edge of the road. I drove past, got out, and circled back to where I could see them, and I found a spot to wait. The spot I picked out was no more than 60 yards from the road, but had thick palmettos. But after I found a little opening and got set up against an oak, I realized the place smelled funny, like hogs and vomit mixed with sewage. But the sun was coming up, and it seemed like a good spot. So I sat and waited. As the sun started really lighting up the woods, both birds started gobbling. I started soft calling, and one flew down towards me. And as it dropped into sight, I realized the palmettos in front of me were too high to see anything on the other side. I'd been so focused on the birds and the roost that I didn't realize I was, in fact, in a bad spot. So I decided to get closer to the palmettos and peek over and pray that I could get a shot off before the turkey saw me. As I got to my knees and raised my head over the palmettos, I was greeted with the smell of vomit, hog, and sewage again, but this time so strong it took my breath away. Out of nowhere, something growled. It was loud and low and made everything inside of me vibrate like I was laying chest first on a large guitar amp. I fell backwards and scrambled to the tree I was originally sitting against. My shotgun was at the base of the palmettos, so I stood up and pulled my pistol and scanned the area, looking for the sound's source. But I saw nothing. Nothing moved. All the noise was gone out of the woods. I knew I needed to get the heck out of there, but I was frozen. I'm not ashamed to admit that I was scared. After what felt like eternity, I forced myself to take a step forward, then a couple more, until I could just reach my shotgun. I reached down and grabbed it, and as I stood back up, another growl, this one deeper and angrier than before. My heart was in my throat, and at this point, I knew whatever that sound was coming from was big, and turkey load and a 9mm was not going to cut it. So I backed up for 15 to 20 yards, looking all around me, but always keeping those palmettos in front of me. I knew at any moment that whatever just growled at me could show itself. I started sidestepping to get to the road, and I must have looked like an idiot, but I couldn't bring myself to turn my back to those palmettos. I made it to the road in the truck. I was shaking and freaked out. I just wanted to get out of there. So I took off. I decided to go down to the river and collect myself. I got down to the fishing hole there and saw other cars and instantly felt better. I pulled out my cell phone, and when I realized that I had a signal, which almost never happens out there, I called a buddy of mine who hunts here regularly. I told him what happened, and he called me a wimp and said I was probably on a bobcat or a Florida panther kill, and I just got lucky. I let some time pass and steadied my nerves, and then I decided to go see if my buddy was right. I left my shotgun in the truck, since birdshot wouldn't do much against a panther or an angry bobcat, but I made sure my pistol was chambered and headed right back to where I had been that morning. It had warmed up quite a bit by now, and I was expecting that smell to be worse, but the smell of hog, vomit, and sewage was replaced by the smell of dead animal, and for the lack of a better term, gut pile. As I got back to the palmettos, I used a machete that I had had in the truck to cut the palmettos away with one hand while I had my pistol aimed with the other. As the palmettos gave way, what I saw still bothers me. My buddy was right. There was a kill site. But it wasn't a bobcat or panther kill. There was a hog with its one back leg twisted in the wrong direction. Its side and belly were ripped open, and its ribs looked like they had been pulled apart and folded over, almost like opening cupboard doors. The insides were a bloody mess, and the one front leg was missing. That's when I realized I was an idiot because I was messing with an active kill site of a big predator, and that was a seriously bad idea. Then the growl came again, this time from behind me, and it wasn't as close as before, but I still felt and heard it. I bolted, like a madman, away from the carcass, through the palmettos, and back to the truck, and then I hauled my ass out of there. And I stayed home the next few days, and nothing else happened that season. I stayed away from Green Swamp the next year. I couldn't shake the two occurrences that had happened there, and I tried hunting on different wildlife management areas all of 2018. My oldest stepson had come home from the Army in 2018 and wanted to start turkey hunting, so I agreed to take him and teach him. But we had no luck at any of the other wildlife management areas that we had tried, so that meant going back to Green Swamp. I had told him I wasn't really comfortable going back there, and I shared my experiences with him. He told me it'll be different since there's two of us. Boy, was he wrong. Occurrence 3 happened in March 2019. Our time for spring turkey had been quiet and typical of public land hunting. I steered miles clear of the areas I had the first two occurrences at, and only had to deal with people walking in on our setup or using calls they really couldn't use and scaring off the birds we had coming in on us. We were having fun, and I kept putting us on birds. We weren't able to harvest any yet, but we were having a blast, and I was happy to be hunting with one of my stepsons. I was actually happy to be in the woods again. By this time, I've started trusting my gut. If an area doesn't feel right, I'm not going near it. And it had worked so far for that season. But on Wednesday, the 27th, we walked into an area off tram grade across from the little footbridge. We went without scouting the area, but nothing ventured, nothing gained, I thought to myself. My stepson said he had a funny feeling about this spot, but I didn't, so we kept going. It was about 45 minutes before sunrise, and we had our headlamps on. We were looking for a place with enough cover for both of us. Then the strangest sound came out of nowhere. It was a whooping sound, the kind I'd heard on those goofy Bigfoot shows I had started watching. So naturally, I thought it was my son messing with me. So I told him to knock it off or he will scare the birds. As he was saying it wasn't him, a second, even louder whoop came from directly above us in the trees. We both dropped into a kneeling stance and were scanning the trees for what just made that noise. My heart was in my throat again, and I could hear it beating in my ears like an over-caffeinated drummer going nuts with his bass drum. There was no noise and no wind, but the branches of the big oaks around us started moving, so we got up and backed out, and we found a different spot. I didn't feel uneasy, but I wasn't taking any chances either. I know owls don't make those sounds, and trees don't move by themselves. Thursday the 28th. We decided that we would hunt along the power lines on tram grade, a spot we hadn't tried yet, but it looked promising as it was an open field lined on both sides by thick cover. I figured we could set up at the bottom of the huge metal towers that the power lines ran across. It was a chilly morning. I missed our turn and had to take the long way to the spot we had picked. We pulled in and got out to get our gear ready. I instantly had a bad feeling. Something was wrong. I'd later find out my son had the same feeling, but kept quiet about it. After I had everything set up and loaded my shotgun, I unholstered my .45 and chambered a round, then sat back down in the truck and took a drink of my coffee. My son was wanting to go set up, but I told him I'm going to wait a few and listen to see if we hear any birds gobble before we go in because of how open it is along the power lines. That's complete BS, but I didn't want him to know that something wasn't right. All we were hearing were whippoorwills and a couple noisy owls doing their normal concerts. 10 minutes pass, and my son needs to water the truck tire. So I get out of the truck to watch for headlights as we are in an open field, and no one wants to see a grown man peeing in a field. As I go to sit back in the truck, everything goes completely quiet, except for the power lines buzzing in the middle of this field. It was so sudden, it hit me like a smack in the face. In my mind, I'm cursing, because I know something felt off. Then there's a low, drawn-out whistle. I felt sick. My son looks at me and says, "Pops, that wasn't a whippoorwill." That's when he noticed my .45 was on my lap with the safety off. He looked blankly at me and said, "I guess you weren't lying when you told me about those stories, huh?" Before I could answer him, another whistle, and I'm on edge. I scan the woods with my headlamp, but see nothing. Just brush and trees, nothing out of place, and I can't hear anything moving. My son goes, "Pops, what was that?" I didn't respond because I don't have an answer. I get out of the truck and start loading my gear back in and close the back door as quietly as I can. and my son does the same. Suddenly, a good distance down the left side power lines, behind the truck, something lets out the most god-awful noise. It sounds like a scream, a growl, and a howl all at the same time, and it's loud. As that one starts to die down, but before it stops, there is a second one. I'm shaking. Me and my son look at each other, and the fear is all over our faces. There's a few seconds of silence, and then from in front of the truck, we hear coyotes. They are squalling and yelping and running. In the beams of our headlamps, we can see a couple break cover, and they are running full tilt away from us and the noise. I looked at my stepson and flatly said, "It's time to go." As we are getting in the truck, a third one of those god-awful sounds. This time, it's closer. Way too close for comfort, and I could feel it in my body. It was on my side of the truck now, and we hauled butt out of there. On the way home, I couldn't figure out how something could move that fast from one side of the field to the other, and then up that side across a road and into the trees without being seen or heard. Then it clicked. It hadn't. There was more than one of those things, and they didn't want us there. The only thing that comes close to the sounds we heard out there is a video on YouTube of a silverback gorilla screaming, but it's not as angry, low, or as drawn out. And the Bigfoot howls that are on YouTube don't quite match it either. It's almost a cross between the two. I'm trying to find answers to a lot of questions, so I figured I'd do some research into Seminole Indian legends, as they've been in Florida a lot longer than anyone else. And it turns out the Seminole tribe was once part of the Creek tribe, and they do have a legend that is like Bigfoot called the Kolowa, which when translated is supposedly the Seminole or Creek word for gorilla. Only difference between the Bigfoot stories and what I could find on the Kolowa is, unlike the Bigfoot tales and legends up north, where he is sometimes peaceful and benevolent, this southern one is a massive and malicious man-eater. Just my luck, instead of Harry and the Hendersons type of creature, I'd find the kind from a horror movie. I kinda wish I hadn't dug into those legends. Well, that's what's happened to me so far. I still haven't decided if I'll go hunting this spring or not, but if I do and anything else happens, I'll be sure to let you know. Thanks for your time, Nathaniel. Hi, Nance. I live on the outskirts of a little town called Draffenville in Kentucky. I am divorced, but have shared custody of our 14-year-old daughter. One weekend when she was with me, we went to land between the lakes to do a little geocaching. When we were done with that, we decided to take a drive through the Elk and Bison Prairie. There's a loop road that runs through the prairie, and you have to stay in your car for obvious reasons. We'd been through there many times before, and we always enjoyed it. On this day, we started by taking the right hand of the loop road around. We had just passed the second pond on the loop, and that's where the road goes up and curves back in a heavy switchback, then goes around parallel to the other side of the road. From there, there's another pond in that switchback area. We were coming through there and going slow as we were trying to see the bison. There had been a few at the pond that we had just passed, but not many, which was surprising. The pond that we were now coming up to has some tree growth around it, but we could still see as we approached it, and we saw that there were some bison milling around. The pond was on the left side of the road, and on the right side is heavy tree growth. We slowed down to a crawl, almost to stop, to look at the bison. We noticed that one of the very large bison stood apart from the small herd that was gathered near the pond. He was staring across the road into the trees. I was worried because he was standing very near to the edge of the road, so close that if I had drove through, I would have been able to reach out and touch him. And I did not want to drive through that close to him. So I stopped maybe 150 to 200 feet down the road. I didn't want to get that close, and the road was fairly straight from there, and I had a clear view. We sat there for maybe a minute or two, waiting for him to move around, or at least away from the road. But we were surprised when he suddenly charged across the road into the trees. We heard an awful racket being made, and within a second or so, we saw something running along the side of the tree thicket to our right. It was moving much faster than the bison, which appeared to be slowed down because of the trees. My daughter and I both saw what could only be called a Sasquatch tearing through the trees away from the bison. Where our car was sitting, there was a small area directly to the right of the car where the tree line dipped in away from the road, so that when the Sasquatch came parallel to our car, it had come out from the trees for just a split second before it went right back into the tree growth and disappeared. The bison had stopped its charge sometime while in the trees, and a few moments later, we saw it walk back across the road, and it joined back up with the herd that had begun to scatter to the far side of the pond when he first charged. We were able to drive through a minute or so later, but the whole time as we were waiting to be clear to drive on, my daughter and I were talking about what it could have been, and we both said it was definitely a Sasquatch. There was no other possible explanation. No one is crazy enough to dress up in a fur suit in the middle of July and start antagonizing bison. It was tall and fast, but it didn't seem to be barrel-chested like a lot of people say they are. I can only tell you that the fur looked a cinnamon red color, and for that brief moment that it was out of the trees and in the sunlight before it disappeared again, I wasn't able to notice much more. But I did notice that the arms were long, and they were swinging heavily as it ran. And that's all I can say from what we saw, because we only saw it from the side and very briefly. That's it. That's my story. Thanks for letting me tell. Wyatt. Hi, Nance. I've experienced a few things here, and I thought I would let others know that they don't have to be afraid of Bigfoot. I live in Fairfield County in Ohio, the western part. We moved here in 2011. In spring 2012, things began to happen. There were lots of things being moved around outside the house. We would hear things at night, but when we would get up and look out a window or go outside to look, we never saw anything and we could never find anything. Sometimes we would hear things like the patio furniture scraping across the cement out back. Sometimes we could hear a sound as if something was walking around or moving along the gravel driveway that ran near the house. It wasn't likely that it was someone pranking us, as where we live is pretty remote. You can't even see our house from the road. There's an earth berm and a heavy tree growth between the house and the road. In fact, if you don't know where to look, you're likely to miss our driveway. We thought perhaps it was just some deer nosing around out there. Of course it wasn't deer, or I wouldn't be emailing this to you. But weird, simple stuff kept happening for about a year, but not enough to alarm us. But there were times when I'd sit outside and I felt strongly as if I was being watched. Finally, in 2013, I got to see what I thought was making all the noise. I had gone out to pick up my teenage son from practice. It was getting dark by the time we got home and pulled in the driveway, and our driveway is fairly long and curves back towards the front of the house, then run along the side of it. We don't have an attached garage, but there is a covered area next to the house that we can pull up into. The headlights of my car automatically come on when it gets dark outside. We had pulled into the driveway, and we almost hit something about halfway up the drive, right where it starts to curve back toward the house. Something large just ran across the road in front of us. I slammed on the brakes, and because we weren't doing more than maybe 5 or 10 miles an hour up the drive, we were stopped immediately. I believe that if we hadn't, we would have hit whatever it was. My son and I were stunned. We looked at each other. What had we just seen? When we got into the house, we both told my husband what had happened. He dismissed it and said we had probably seen a bear or some deer or something like that. Nothing to be alarmed about. I really wanted to believe him, but neither me nor my son agreed that it could have possibly been either of the things he suggested. My husband asked me, well, What did I think it was? I didn't have an answer. But it was starting to get bolder, and I guess it thought we weren't a problem for it to be there. A few weeks after that incident in the driveway, my husband saw it. It was standing near the edge of the driveway again, roughly about where we had almost hit it a few weeks prior. My husband said he was coming up the drive and he saw something off to the side, so he slowed down to see what it was. He flipped on the high beams from the car, and he said it immediately covered its face with its arm and turned away. He said it didn't run, but just walked further back into the trees where he could no longer see it. He said it was at least 3 seconds or more that he had a good view of its broad, muscular back before it disappeared. He was stunned, but now he agreed that it wasn't any of the things he told us a few weeks ago that it probably was. But we have never felt threatened or in danger by this thing. We think it's just curious, and its curiosity about the house and moving things around outside stopped within that year. We believe that it was just curious about the new things it saw, as we had been told that the previous owner of this house was elderly and didn't spend any time outside. We recalled that when we first viewed the house, it didn't look like anyone had been out back or taken care of anything for a long time, and there was nothing out there on the patio or the cement. We do think that it is what has gotten into our trash at the end of the driveway more than once since then. I have only seen it one more time since then in all these years. Although our house is brick, the soffits, eaves, and window casings do need painted from time to time, and clearly they hadn't been done for years. I was scraping the wood around a window when I caught a reflection of movement in the glass behind me. It was just the movement that I saw. I realized it was something behind me, all the way at the edge of where the clear property and the wooded property met. It wasn't close to me, so I wasn't scared. But I stayed still, and I did not turn around to look immediately. Once it had passed from the vision of the glass reflection, I turned around. It was overcast that day, so there was no sun glare. It was probably 100 to 120 feet from me at that point. The shape of the thing was very clear, even though I mostly saw it from the side profile as it continued to walk along the tree path. It was maybe 7 to 10 feet inside the line of trees. It was just enough that it wasn't out in the open, but not so far back that I couldn't see it. It was a dark brown color, maybe close to black. I did notice the freakishly long arms that hung to where I thought its knees were and where it seemed the legs were bending. I only had maybe a couple more seconds to really watch it as it was covering the distance back there very fast. It never looked my way. Later that day, when my husband came home, we walked out to where I had seen it. We saw what might have been light indentations out there, but not what you would call a clear print, and it was hard for us to tell with forest debris. Yes, I know there are ways to tell now, but we didn't know that then. He measured, and he said the stride was almost 4 feet. I haven't seen the creature since, and to my knowledge, no one else in the family has either, but I don't think that it's left the area. Anything new that we put outside seems to be investigated within a couple days. I've not left it food or gifts. We aren't looking for that kind of interaction. It's done us no harm to person or property, and none of us have the feeling that it will. I know everyone is scared of Bigfoot, but we kind of like ours. Thanks a lot, Melissa. Hi, Nance. I've had some encounters in my life that are pretty much out there. Some are with malevolent spirits and some are with Sasquatch. I've always believed in ghosts and Bigfoot. My first encounter with Bigfoot was about 3.5 years ago when me and my family moved to Peebles, Ohio. First, you have to know that I smoke, but I don't in the house because of my kids. Well, anyway, I was sitting on the back of this U-Haul truck smoking, and there's a hill that is about 500 or 600 feet from my house. It sounded like someone was running across it pretty fast and was screaming all the way across it. Now this hill is about 400 feet tall, but is really long. The lung capacity of this thing creeped me out, so I went in the house. Well, about 2 weeks later, I heard the same thing again, but not running across the hill, but staying in the same place. It had a different tone, like maybe it was female, but it kept the duration about the same as the first one. I can't say for how long, maybe 30 seconds. Now, 7 months later, a friend of my oldest son showed up and we got to talking about Bigfoot. He pulled out his phone and showed me a video of something's footprints in the snow going across his backyard, up a hill, and across a field. But what struck me as funny was it came across a tree that had fallen, and you could see where it jumped across it. Its left heel had scraped the snow on the log. Skip a few years. On July 3rd, I was riding my four-wheeler down Grassy Fork when I saw three cars, two being cops. So I turned around and went home, but in the process, I lost my hat. I waited about an hour and then went back looking for my hat. Now I have to tell you that I have a Can-Am 400 horsepower, so it's quick, but not neck-breaking quick. It will hit about 55 or 60 miles per hour. It has headlights and taillights, but they're not the best. So I took a flashlight with me. About where I thought I lost my hat, I slowed down and I started to look for it. As I'm going down the road really slow, to my left, I see a man waving his arms. I stop, thinking he needs help. He was screaming at me to get the hell out of there, and he was pointing across the road. I looked to where he was pointing, and what I saw was absolutely the most terrifying thing I had ever seen in my life. Have you ever been so scared that it makes you see white spots? When I looked over, this thing was on the side of the road, no more than maybe 9 feet away from me. It was probably about the same height or around 8 feet. So I gunned my four-wheeler and got out of there. I went to a church that was about a mile away, and I sat there for about an hour. I started back home, and there was that thing walking down the road. Nance, I have to say, I was absolutely terrified at that point in time. But this time, we had eye contact for a few, and I had nowhere to go except right past this thing. And by the way, I don't have my favorite hat anymore, but I have one more encounter with Bigfoot and an encounter with a skywalker that maybe I'll share later. Everyone, pay attention to your surroundings and be safe. I love your channel and keep the good fight. Wendell. Hello there. My name is Matthew, and I had a terrifying encounter in Preble County, Ohio, in late May of 2008. My brother and myself had multiple properties that we hunted that all joined each other, equaling almost 1,000 acres. We found out that someone was sneaking back there and were growing marijuana here and there. Not on our watch. So we would just about weekly go back there at night and let it be known that we were monitoring the area, and hopefully that would deter any wannabe growers from their activities. Most of the time, we were together, and sometimes we would go in alone. It depended on our schedules. On this particular night, I was alone as I headed back. It was approximately 1 a.m. To access the first place I was going, you had to walk down a trail about 150 to 200 yards. This goes through some thick timber before the first field. I remember I had to pee so bad, and about halfway down the trail I stopped, did a quick shine around with my flashlight before I would put down my rifle to relieve myself. To my right, about 15 yards, I quickly noticed an eye shine about 6 feet off the ground looking from behind a tree. Very bright greenish-yellow eye shine. I didn't think anything other than, that's a raccoon on that tree, as they are everywhere out there. So I turned my light off, put it in my pocket, and turned to put my rifle against a tree so I could take care of business. But just as soon as the butt of my rifle touched the ground, a very loud whistle came from behind me, very, very close in the direction of where the eyeshine I had just seen was. My first thought was, who in the hell just whistled at me? I turned around and turned my light back on, and the eyeshine that I had just seen peeking around the tree is now standing around 15 feet from that same tree. I'm in shock, wondering, what in the world am I looking at? And right at this moment, directly behind me, I would guess about 40 feet, came the most god-awful, intense, terrifying growl I've ever heard in my life, and it hit me, literally hit me. I had walked in between two of those things. To say I was terrified is an understatement. It's at times like this, it is fight or flight, and I chose fight. I'm always well armed, and this night I was carrying an FAL, which is a semi-automatic 308 caliber detachable magazine fed rifle. I flicked the safety off and just put out a wall of lead. I emptied a 20-round magazine and put in another 30-round magazine, and when I got to the entrance of the trail, I only had 3 rounds left in my gun. I had shot 47 rounds in just a few seconds. I don't care what anyone says about how I handled the situation, because I'm still alive to tell the story. The next day, my brother and I went back to the same spot to get the empty magazine I dropped and to look around. We couldn't find any tracks, as the ground was rather dry anyway, and we didn't find anything but bullet holes in some trees. That's the last time I ever went into the woods alone at night. That is a night I will remember forever. I thought I was going to die. When I was a teenager, my parents moved us to a property very near the Richland State Forest. The house sat on 9 partially wooded acres. It was very rural and very quiet. We moved there in the winter, so if there were things going on around the property at that time, none of us were outside to know about it. But when spring came, we were all outside, the whole family, an awful lot. We were trying to shape up the property the way we wanted it. This meant we always had a large pile of brush waiting to be burned. And most weekends, we sat out at night and burned the pile of cut brush and clippings. One night, while sitting out around the burning brush pile, me, my brother, and our parents heard something stomping around. It was moving and breaking limbs in the trees that lined the edge of the property on the west side. We were not near the trees, and we couldn't see beyond the fire. The trees were about 100 feet away from where we were, so the sounds were very loud to reach us that far over the fire. The sounds finally stopped, but later, and not long before we were going to go in, we began to hear a hollow banging noise. It didn't sound like a solid something hitting a tree. It sounded more like 2 baseball bats being banged together. The sound was hollow and had a higher pitch than a dull thud, which I imagined is how it would sound if someone was just hitting a tree. We hadn't been there long enough to know if this was something that perhaps a neighbor was doing. Was this normal? We didn't know, so we just passed it off. We heard weird sounds many nights out there, but we still weren't sure if it was happening on our property or the neighbor's property. And truth be told, none of us cared enough to go find out and look in the darkness, which, by the way, was the only time we ever heard any noises. We never heard them during the day or in the afternoon, but only at night when it was dark. During the nights with nice weather, I would sleep with my bedroom window open to get the breeze. My brother's bedroom was across the hall. My room was on the corner that overlooked the back of the house, and his was on the front corner of the house. That meant that if we both had our windows open, the breeze would come through my window and go right out his window, and it created a constant flowing breeze across both of us. One night, I was awakened by a terrible smell. It was worse than a fresh skunk spray. My eyes watered. I sat up and I was gagging in my bed when I could hear my brother across the hall doing the same. He then accused me of passing some awful gas, to which I told him that if that was me that smelled like that, I would need to see a doctor. The smell had come through my window and went right across the hall and out his window. So I looked out my window, but it was too dark to see anything out there. A few nights later, we smelled that terrible smell again. Once the smell came, it just stayed, even after whatever it was had brought the smell had moved on. This time we were in the living room, with the windows open. Our parents were sitting there, and they both smelled it as well. None of us knew what it was. Me and my brother never saw what it was, but my father did. It was that fall, and that's when we knew we had a Bigfoot on our land. Dad said that he was up on the garage roof, looking for whatever had been clogging the gutters and the downspout on that end of the house. From up there, he said he had a clear view all the way well into the tree line. With most of the leaves off the trees, he said it was easy to spot the creature as it moved. He described it as being about 7 feet tall, and that really was a guess, he said. But he could tell that the fur had a reddish-brown color to it. The creature was a couple hundred feet away from where he was on the garage roof, and it was moving in the wooded area on the northwest parcel of our property, very near where a natural pond was. He watched it for a good minute to a minute and a half until it was out of sight. He said it was moving at a steady pace, and it seemed to know exactly where it was going, never stopping, never hesitating, and it wasn't distracted from its path. Now, I believe my father when he described what he saw, and when he said that the only thing that fit the description was a Bigfoot, well, I believed him. He was very clear that it couldn't have possibly been a bear. It was walking very upright, and the stride was too long. Among other reasons, he said it could not be a bear. After that, all of us were more aware of the things we might hear at night, and none of us slept with the windows open anymore. It didn't bother us, but we also went out of our way to not bother it. None of us ever saw it again, and we do think that it left the next spring, as we did not hear the sounds at night anymore the next year. So that's my story. And by the way, this was back in the 1980s and took place in Vinton County, Ohio. Thanks, Michael. Nance, here's my sighting that I told you about back before Christmas. This happened in 2014. It was me and my dad. We'd gone out to Clear Creek, which is south of Lancaster. We were checking roosting spots for turkeys. Usually, we can go in, find our signs, mark the roost trees, and then come back and set up for first thing in the morning. The terrain there in Clear Creek varies a lot, and it can be challenging in spots. We had been following a particular deep-cut ravine, looking for signs of turkey droppings, feathers, and the like. And we were listening for any sounds of turkeys gobbling or the giveaway tree fluttering noises. We were just looking around in the ravine and also looking up on the steep slopes for possible roost trees. Oddly, to us anyway, we saw no sign and we heard absolutely nothing. We had turkey hunted this area many times over the years and had always had great success. But there was no sound of anything that day. There was no birds, no squirrels, No breeze rustling leaves, nothing. It was a flat, dense, void of sound kind of silence. And there was just no normal background noise that you normally hear in the woods, and we both noticed it. We weren't expecting to run smack into a Bigfoot, but as we followed that ravine, that is what we almost did. It had been standing very near a cluster of trees, about 30 feet from the bank of the ravine where we were. We almost walked by it and missed it. It was standing so still. But as I was sweeping my eyes up and down the slopes looking for turkey roosts, I saw it standing there. At the same time, so did my dad. Tall, yes. Dark hair, yes. Upright, football-shaped head, yes. Very wide, muscular body, you bet. Its face, though, did seem to have a human look to it. But yet, it was not human. It was human enough, however, that it seemed to me, at least, to have an expression. And I would have to say that was a blank expression. The eyes were deep set under the brows, and they looked very dark, possibly black. It was clearly looking at us, like it was waiting for us to either keep moving or back up. I didn't know what it expected us to do, but I think it expected us to make the first move. It was a very surreal moment. What do you do when you walk up on a Bigfoot? Should you do anything? I didn't know. I still don't know. It appeared that it had been trying to stay hidden there by the trees. But once it knew that we had seen it, it dropped all pretense of trying to hide. It moved in a deliberate fashion up the slope on a diagonal away from us and the ravine. It did turn a couple times as it walked to check our positions. Neither of us had moved a muscle. And we neither one were armed with anything more than a handgun for personal protection. We had gone out there to scout roosts, not to do hunting. I don't think that both of us firing our handguns together could have taken down such a large creature before it got to us, if that was what it had wanted to do. So it was with great relief that we watched it move away from us. I should add that this occurred in April, and that at that time not all the trees had leafed out and filled out, so we had a good view of it as it left our area, and it did so in a very calm manner. I can't say the same about us, though. We weren't all that calm when we vacated that area. We got out of there pretty fast. Me and Dad both agreed that even though it didn't seem to be a threat to us, we weren't going to test our luck by going turkey hunting the next day. Thanks for letting me tell my story, Brett. In the early 1970s, my dad, my brothers and sisters, built a log cabin in St. Lucie, located on the Laurentian Mountains in Quebec, Canada. It was hard work. I remember peeling logs at 6 years old along with my siblings. We had a great time. We traveled every weekend an hour and a half to get to the cabin. We grew up there in the summertime. As I got older, my husband and I bought a place right next to my dad's old cabin. My grandkids would come up with me on the weekends, too. My neighbor called me over one day and showed me this type of bedding that was made from pine boughs. We didn't think much of it and went on with our day. The next weekend, my grandson called to me from the bedroom and said, "Grandma, there's something walking outside." He was right. I could hear it walking. Mind you, I had a generator running and we could hear it walking. It seemed to be big. The footfalls were loud enough to hear over the generator. I was there alone with my 14-year-old grandson. I was afraid to look out. I locked the doors right away. I knew what it was, but didn't want my grandson to be scared. A few weekends later, we decided to go look at the bedding site. Amazingly, it was gone, like he or she picked it up and moved it. And they moved it all right, right next to my cabin, about 30 feet away. The next day, this creature kept throwing sticks at the cabin, even in the daytime, all day. Finally, around supper time, my son and daughter-in-law with my other grandson came by. It stopped as they pulled in. I knew right where he was, but didn't want to scare my family. What's crazy is my son decided to build his own cabin, so he would stay at mine while he was building his. One evening, he was taking a shower. You know, one of those black shower jugs you leave hanging on a tree all day to heat up the water? Anyway, he said it was evening. He looked up and saw this big, huge black figure staring at him. It was at least 8 feet tall behind the old outhouse. He ran inside and locked the doors behind him. My nephew, who was building the cabin with him, asked him, "What's wrong?" He replied, "There's something out there. Don't go outside." He said he could hear it take off through the brush, knocking trees down. What's crazy is my son never told me this story. My uncle told me this a good 10 years plus after my son had built his cabin. He never told me a thing. I guess he didn't want to scare me, but after hearing the big guy walking outside, I sold my place and never went back. I would dream of the Bigfoot talking to me and wake up in a sweat. Even though I didn't see him, I know he's out there. My son would tell me not to be afraid, that they mean no harm, that they want to be left alone, and that they will speak to people who would understand, that being those of the Mohawk descent. I understood what he was telling me, so give him his space and respect, and they will watch over you. But if you try to harm them, you will pay dearly. Thank you for listening, Grandma.